Grace, mercy, and peace from God our Father and the Lord Jesus Christ be with you.
And also with you.
This is the day the Lord has made.
Let us rejoice and be glad in it.
The night is far spent, and the day is at hand. Let us therefore cast off the works of darkness and put on the armour of light. Welcome to this service of morning prayer for Advent Sunday, recorded from the Church of St. Michael, Sutton on the Hill. The latest news is that we can hold public worship again in our churches from next Sunday, although sad to relate, we in Derbyshire will be in Tier 3 of the anti-COVID measures from Wednesday. Today is Advent Sunday, the beginning of the church's year. So, Happy New Year to you. This year, our Gospel readings will come mostly from Mark, but as his Gospel is the shortest, we shall also have considerable sections from John's Gospel too. Advent is a season of expectation and preparation. The church prepares to celebrate the coming of Christ, not only in his incarnation, but also looks ahead to his final advent as judge at the end of time. The readings not only direct us towards Christ's birth, they also challenge the modern reluctance to confront the theme of divine judgment. The four last things, death, judgment, heaven, and hell, have been traditional themes for Advent meditation. The characteristic note of Advent is of alert watchfulness and expectation rather than of penitence. Our music comes from the choir of St. Martin in the Fields. I'm very grateful to Sue Hartley and Phil Savage, who are doing our Bible readings today, and to David for recording, all of whom are essential to our service today. Thank you, Sue, Phil, and David. We begin our service with that great Advent hymn, O Come, Emmanuel.
Thank you.
we have come together in the name of Christ to offer our praise and thanksgiving, to hear and receive God's holy word, to pray for the needs of the world, and to seek the forgiveness of our sins, that by the power of the Holy Spirit we may give ourselves to the service of God. When the Lord comes, he will bring to light the things now hidden in darkness and will disclose the purposes of the heart. Therefore, in the light of Christ, let us confess our sins. God, through Jesus Christ, will judge the secret thoughts of all. Lord, have mercy.
Lord, have mercy.
Not everyone who says to me, Lord, Lord, will open the kingdom of heaven. Christ, have mercy.
Christ, have mercy.
Let anyone who has an ear listen to what the Spirit is saying to the churches. Lord, have mercy.
Lord, have mercy.
May the Father of all mercies cleanse you from your sins and restore you in his image to the praise and glory of his name. Through Jesus Christ, our Lord.
Amen.
The night has passed, and the day lies open before us. Let us pray with one heart and mind. As we rejoice in the gift of this new day, so may the light of your presence, O God, set our hearts on fire with love for you, now and forever.
Amen.
The psalm appointed for today is Psalm 80, verses 1 to 8, 18 to 20. Hear, O shepherd of Israel, you that led Joseph like a flock.
Shine forth, you that are enthroned upon the cherubim, before Ephraim, Benjamin, and Manasseh.
Stir up your mighty strength and come to our salvation.
Turn again, O God, show the light of your countenance, and we shall be saved.
O Lord God of hosts, how long will you be angry at your people's prayer?
You feed them with the bread of tears. You give them abundance of tears to drink.
You have made us the derision of our neighbours, and our enemies laugh us to scorn.
Turn us again, O God of hosts. Show the light of your countenance, and we shall be saved.
Let your hand be upon the man at your right hand, the son of man you made so strong for yourself.
And so will we not go back from you. Give us life, and we shall call upon your name.
Turn us again, O Lord God of hosts. Show the light of your countenance, and we shall be saved.
Glory to the Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Spirit, as it was in the beginning, is now, and shall be forever. Amen.
A reading from the book of the prophet Isaiah, chapter 64, beginning at the first verse. Oh, that you would tear open the heavens and come down, so that the mountains would quake at your presence, as when the fire kindles brushwood and the fire causes water to boil, to make your name known to your adversaries, so that the nations may tremble at your presence. When you did awesome deeds that we did not expect, you came down, the mountains quaked at your presence. From ages past, no one has heard, no ear has perceived, no eye has seen my God besides you, who works for those who wait for him. You meet those who gladly do right, those who remember you in your ways. But you were angry, and we sinned. Because you hid yourself, we transgressed. We have all become like one who is unclean, and all our righteous deeds are like a filthy cloth. We all fade like a leaf, and our iniquities, like the wind, take us away. There is no one who calls on your name or attempts to take hold of you. For you have hidden your face from us and have delivered us into the hand of our iniquity. Yet, O Lord, you are our Father. We are the clay and you are our potter. We're all the work of your hand. Do not be exceedingly angry, O Lord, and do not remember iniquity forever. Now consider, we are all your people. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Canticle is a song of the wilderness. The wilderness and the dry land shall rejoice. The desert shall blossom and burst into song. They shall see the glory of the Lord, the majesty of our God. Strengthen the weary hands and make firm the feeble knees. Say to the anxious, be strong, fear not. Your God is coming with judgment to save you. Then shall the eyes of the blind be opened, and the ears of the deaf unstopped. Then shall the lame leap like a hart, and the tongue of the dumb sing for joy. For waters shall break forth in the wilderness, and streams in the desert. The ransomed of the Lord shall return with singing, with everlasting joy upon their heads. Joy and gladness shall be theirs, and sorrow and sighing shall flee away. Glory to the Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Spirit, as it was in the beginning, is now, and shall be forever. Amen.
A reading from the Gospel according to Mark, chapter 13, beginning at the 24th verse. But in those days after that suffering, the sun will be darkened, and the moon will not give its light, and the stars will be falling from heaven, and the powers in the heavens will be shaken. Then they will see the Son of Man coming in clouds, with great power and glory. Then he will send out the angels and gather his elect from the four winds, from the ends of the earth to the ends of heaven. From the fig tree, learn its lesson. As soon as its branch becomes tender and puts forth its leaves, you know that summer is near. So also, when you see these things taking place, you know that he is near at the very gates. Truly, I tell you, this generation will not pass away until all these things have taken place. Heaven and earth will pass away, but my words will not pass away. But about that day or hour, no one knows, neither the angels in heaven nor the Son, but only the Father. Beware, keep alert, for you do not know when the time will come. It is like a man going on a journey when he leaves home and puts his slaves in charge, each with his work, and commands the doorkeeper to be on the watch. Therefore, keep awake, for you do not know when the master of the house will come, in the evening, or at midnight, or at cockcrow, or at dawn, or else he might find you asleep when he comes suddenly. And what I say to you, I say to all, Keep awake. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
The Benedictus. Blessed be the Lord, the God of Israel, who has come to his people and set them free. He has raised up for us a mighty Saviour, born of the house of his servant David. Through his holy prophets, God promised of old to save us from our enemies, from the hands of all that hate us, to show mercy to our ancestors, and to remember his holy covenant. This was the oath God swore to our father Abraham, to set us free from the hands of our enemies, free to worship him without fear, holy and righteous in his sight all the days of our life. And you, child, shall be called the prophet of the Most High, for you will go before the Lord to prepare his way, to give his people knowledge of salvation by the forgiveness of all their sins, in the tender compassion of our God. The dawn from on high shall break upon us to shine on those who dwell in darkness and the shadow of death, and to guide our feet into the way of peace. Glory to the Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Spirit, as it was in the beginning, is now, and shall be forever. Amen. May the words of my mouth and the thoughts of all our hearts be acceptable in your sight, O Lord, our rock and our redeemer. Amen.
Amen.
When will this world disaster of COVID-19 come to an end? When will I be able to get another job? How will my business be able to function again? What are we to do about global warming? All questions on people's lips, as our lives are on hold as we face this catastrophe. We all want to know when and how we can begin to plan our lives again. Jesus is talking to his disciples in today's reading from Mark's Gospel. The images he uses are all about disaster, with the world in a cataclysmic crisis. You can feel the disciples' fear as Jesus describes the sun darkened and stars falling from heaven. Then they will see the Son of Man coming in the clouds. He will send out his angels and gather his elect from the four winds, a reference to the book of Daniel and an image of the judgment to come. But notice that the Son of Man will come and gather, not words to associate with the doom predicted. When Christ comes again, there will be judgment, but also a gathering into God's kingdom. Will we be part of this gathering into this new creation? Jesus warns the disciples to watch out for critical events which will announce the end. The disciples want to know when this will happen, but not even Jesus knows the answer. Clearly, the particular disaster envisaged in Mark's Gospel is the destruction of the temple. The fall of Jerusalem and the destruction of the temple came in AD 70. Pagan armies overran the holy city, and the Jewish way of life, centered around worship in the temple, came to an end. What we see from this reading is the fragility of the embryonic church just being gathered by Jesus as the Son of Man in a dangerous world. The young church found a new way to worship God and follow their faith through Jesus. It was unencumbered by institutional structures and buildings. It learnt through the apostles Peter and Paul that their place was out there in the world, among the Gentiles, which meant their mission was to all the people of the world, not just faithful Jews, and certainly not stuck in the temple. In the Archdeacon's charge to the church wardens last week, Archdeacon Christopher quoted from a member of a contemplative monastic community. We talk and teach about Christ, and that is excellent. But those who let Christ shine through their persons and their lives do better. And their silent talk is heard by the deaf ears of their contemporaries. I can think of many in our parishes, and certainly not just the church wardens, whose silent talk is being heard by the apparently deaf ears in our communities. The gathering of provisions for local food banks, keeping an eye on the vulnerable, being visible when something needs doing, communicating by telephone with the housebound, and so on and so forth. The people Isaiah is addressing complain that God has deserted them. They recall the times when God was very obviously present, with Moses in the burning bush, and with Elijah and the prophets of Baal. But now, they say, because you hid yourself, we transgressed. They want to put the blame for their sinfulness on God. But by the end of the passage, they've realized that it was not God who was absent from them, but they who were absent from God. Like so many people today, they felt they had no need of God. Then they remember that they are God's people and the work of God's hand. It is a distressing human trait that we always look for someone to blame. We're always looking for a scapegoat. I've recently sat in a number of Zoom meetings where the future of the church has been the chief topic. During the last 8 months, we've had to learn to worship and do mission in different ways. Digital communication has enabled us to take the church into people's homes, although many of us long to get back to worship in our beautiful medieval buildings. It is becoming increasingly clear that as we emerge from this disaster, our worship will probably take on a mixed economy. For the housebound who are digitally connected, online services have been a revelation and a blessing. For those like farmers and shift workers whose work does not allow them to be in church at a fixed time on Sunday, they can still feel a part of the worshipping community at home. Like the people in Isaiah who had turned away from God, or the disciples listening to Jesus' prediction of destruction, we need to be alert to signs that may indicate God's presence in unexpected places and at unexpected times. The world disaster of COVID has given us an opportunity to see God in new ways. People keep saying that things will be different post-COVID. They will be. We need to be watchful and embrace new ways of being faithful followers of Christ. I pray that this Advent will not be the usual frantic rush of buying and preparing too many things to consume, but that we have time to reflect and consider what good things we've learnt through COVID. Then we may be ready for the coming of the Son of Man, however and whenever that may be. Amen. We affirm our faith in the words of the Apostles' Creed. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended to the dead. On the third day he rose again. He ascended into heaven. He is seated at the right hand of the Father. and he will come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. Let us pray. Watchful at all times, let us pray for strength to stand with confidence before our Maker and Redeemer, that God may bring in his kingdom with justice and mercy. Let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
That God may establish among the nations his sceptre of righteousness. We pray for the leaders of the nations and for our own government. Give them wisdom to serve the needs of all people. Let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
That we may seek Christ in the scriptures and recognize him in the breaking of the bread. Let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
That God may bind up the brokenhearted, restore the sick, and raise up all who have fallen. We pray for those whose jobs are in jeopardy, for all those who are worried for their future. Let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
That the light of God's coming may dawn on all who live in darkness and the shadow of death. We pray for those who have died, especially those known to us, and for those who mourn their loss. Let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
That with all the saints in light, we may shine forth as lights for the world. We pray for our communities, giving thanks for those whose silent talk speaks so powerfully of Christ. Let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
We commend ourselves and all for whom we pray to the mercy and protection of our Heavenly Father. Almighty God, as your blessed Son, Jesus Christ, first came to seek and to save the lost, so may he come again to find in us the completion of his redeeming work. For he is now alive and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, God, for ever and ever.
Amen.
Almighty God, give us grace to cast away the works of darkness and to put on the armour of light, now in the time of this mortal life, in which your Son Jesus Christ came to us in great humility, that on the last day, when he shall come again in his glorious majesty to judge the living and the dead, we may rise to the life immortal through him who is alive and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. Amen. Being made one by the power of the Spirit, as our Saviour taught us, so we pray. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done, on earth as in heaven. Give us today our daily bread. Forgive us our sins, as we forgive those who sin against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever. Amen. Christ, the Son of righteousness, shine upon you. Scatter the darkness from before your path, and make you ready to meet him when he comes in glory. And the blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit be amongst you and remain with you always. Amen. Amen. And we're going to hear the hymn sung by St. Martin's Voices, Longing for Light, We Wait in Darkness. As we await our coming Saviour, go in peace to love and serve the Lord.
In the name of Christ. Amen.